Hey everybody, this is Jean-Paul from Clutch, and you are watching BareBonesMusic.com.
Agent X of BareBonesMusic.com. Sitting to the right of me is John Paul, drummer for Clutch. Now, you guys had a live two-disc DVD come out recently called Clutch, Live at the 930. Just tell us about the history of that club.
Well, coming up in the D.C. area, the 930 Club was the spot to go to see punk music, industrial music, hardcore, metal, off-the-wall stuff. I saw so many shows there coming up. Saw the Bad Brains. Saw Scream. Saw Fugazi.
Yeah.
I remember seeing Nirvana there before the big record came out. Cro-Mags, Bad Brains, man. That was really the show. I got to see Bad Brains in 1989, right after I graduated high school, right before Quickness came out. And man, they just turned that place into a church. You know,
yeah.
I mean, it was a spiritual time, I think, and that really changed my life. So the 930 Club was a very special place. The old spot they tore down, and they made a much bigger club, much nicer place to hang out and see shows. And that's really our hometown club.
Now, on the DVD, you guys play the self-titled album in its entirety. Why did you guys pick that album? Is that kind of Clutch's, if you will, Sgt. Pepper? Or Pet Sounds album?
I think, I don't know if it's our Sgt. Pepper.
Yeah.
I don't think it's that good. But
so you haven't done your Sgt. Pepper yet?
Not yet.
That's to come.
I think that was really a turning point for the band. I think we really found a sound. We made that record after being on tour for quite some time. That was our first extended tour that we'd done as a band. And I think we learned a lot on that tour. We really learned to play our instruments, and we were listening to a lot of music because we were on the road.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that record's really a turning point. And then to be able to play that record in its entirety was, you know, that was a totally different set of challenges. You know, you're listening to stuff that you haven't played or really thought about in some cases 15 years, you know.
Wow.
So
yeah.
It was definitely an educational experience. And it was a great time. It was a lot of fun to go back and listen to, you know, where your head was at.
Yeah.
You listen back to it now with a different perspective. So it was a lot of fun.
Very cool. Now, Strange Cousins from the West is your latest album. It's your ninth studio album. Now, for this one, you said you kind of went back to the brass tacks, kind of stripped it down.
Mm-hmm.
There's no keyboard player on this any other really auxiliary instruments, I believe. What was the need for stripping it down and kind of going back to basics?
Well, when we finished the Beale Street tour, you know, we made some changes in the band. We got rid of our keyboardist. We had Eric Oblander of Five Horse Johnson playing harp, and he was a great player and a lot of fun to play with too. But we knew it was time to switch gears a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think we also knew that in the back of our minds we were going to be making a move as far as how we were going to do business as a band. And so for us that meant really starting our own label. And so it just seemed sort of fitting to make the first Clutch record on our own label.
Mm-hmm.
Be just sort of a more stripped down approach to what we do as a band. You know, good stuff came from it, and who knows what's going to happen with the next record.
Yeah, definitely. Now, speaking of your own label, Weathermaker Records, you guys started out actually on major labels, and you kind of
sure.
transitioned to some other majors and went to some more indie routes, and now you're on your own.
Right.
What does that say about the other record labels out there as far as your transitioning?
The landscape of the music business is completely different than it was 15 years ago.
Yeah.
When we made our very first release, we were on a very small indie label. And everybody was getting signed at the time, and so we were picked up by a major label. And all through the 90s was kind of a tough time for us because we would put out a record with a major label. It would sell a few copies. But in the end, I think it was frustrating for the label because they saw that we had this fan base out there, but they couldn't really make it bigger than it really was. So that was frustrating for them. It was frustrating for us because we sort of felt handicapped. We were often having to sit around and wait 2-3 years sometimes to make another record. So it was a tough time for the band. Looking back on it now, you know, a label is in business for one reason, and that's to make money off of your music, you know.
Yeah.
It used to be sort of cool to be on an indie label. You know, people would think that you sort of had some kind of like street cred or whatever.
Yeah.
Nothing could be further from the truth. These are people who are in the business of taking money from your albums. So we knew that from the very get. With having our own label, you know, all those politics, all that stress, all my least favorite parts of the industry are kind of, you know, on the sidelines now. Certainly there are times where you still have to deal with some bureaucracy and some some politics and stuff. But for the most part, I mean, we are a self-contained unit, and we make the records that we want to make, and it's just great to be able to put them out how we want to put them out.
Absolutely, yeah. Now, I've heard that you guys are pretty relentless in the studio. I mean, you and your producer will sit down, you'll try out every snare drum there is, every mic combination that there is, just to get, you know, the right sound for that particular song on the album. So you guys are very much, you know, a studio band, but at the same time, you guys are road dogs. You play about, would you say, probably about 150 shows a year, which is clutch. Or are you both? Are you a studio band or a live band?
I think we're a better studio band than we used to be.
Mm-hmm.
It's impossible to get that level of energy that happens on stage in the studio.
Right.
It's a really difficult thing to do. I think we're getting better at it, though, and I think consequently our records sound better than they used to sound. But still, you can't get that live energy in the studio. That's quite a challenge.
And as far as you guys playing live, it seems like you never play the same set twice. Why is that important to you?
Well, I think it keeps a freshness to the set. You know, sometimes you're out for a month, 2 months at a time, playing these songs every night. You know, and it's like anything else. You know, it can be a drag sometimes, and so we do everything we can to shake it up and not have it be that way. Years ago, we started a system where on the very first night of a tour, Dan would make the first set list. Tonight's the second night of the tour, so I will make the set list.
Okay.
And then Neil, and then Tim, and I think because of that, we have a wider catalog of songs to pull from.
Mm-hmm.
And then each guy, you know, makes his attempt to sort of just, you know, read the venue, the crowd, what was it like last time we were here, and you sort of make a set list thinking about those kinds of things. You know, if there's some new jams that we're interested in putting in the set, maybe somebody will say, let's try that. Nothing's worse than going to see a band and knowing that in between the third and the fourth song is where the guy shouts out a Dimebag tribute or,
right.
Or you know, this is the craziest crowd that we've ever seen, or... You know, I mean, it's not really a rock concert anymore. It's like a school play.
Right.
And I know that I really dislike that part of a show. And I think Clutch fans do too. You know, people, Clutch fans see right through that kind of shtick, you know. So we try to stay away from that.
This question actually comes from one of our BareBonesMusic.com fans. Mm-hmm. He commented that the bass and the drums sound so tight always. It's almost like it's just one instrument. And he was wondering if that is typically how a song starts to come together with the bass and the drums, or does it more come off a guitar riff? Or
all different ways. You know, a song can come at you from any angle. Sometimes it will be just a bass and drums groove. You know, maybe Dan and I will hit a pocket together, and then the other guys just sort of jump in with some stuff, and then before you know it, there's a song.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it'll start with just Neil. Maybe he's got a riff. Neil's really good at coming up with what sounds like whole songs a lot of times. You know, he'll just come over and say, I got this riff and this little vocal line. And we're like, dude, that's a song. You know,
Done,
you know. So it's fun. The songwriting process is just as organic, hopefully, as the live show is, you know. It's really always changing. And I think we're getting better at writing songs.
I'd say so. I don't think you guys are ever not good at it, but yeah, definitely.